And as you go in, you get to the point where the merchandise hits the border, and you're forced with a decision to transport it inbound. Let's say merchandise comes in at the port of Los Angeles, but it clears in New York. It goes by rail to the New York, and it goes through the customs clearance in New York, but it arrives in San Francisco. So what's the procedure for that? Then you have you have this situation. Once it hits the border, right, who can enter it, right? Can the Chinese exporter can they be officially the importer of record, or the person who is responsible for all the duties and charges, or can they be excluded? Can the carrier, can the railroad be the importer, right? Who can file those entries and who can take responsibility? Then you go to the issue of delegation through the power of attorney. Then you go to the entry of merchandise as far as day, time, entry type. Is it for consumption? Is it for warehouse? What type of products are there? How will it affect? Is it personal? Is it informal? Is it commercial? Which gets you to the topic of more minuscule stuff of what's the entry time? What's the entry date? What's the relevance of that? How do you submit duties, right? How do you submit taxes? And why do you want to submit taxes in the first place? You have invoices. When the merchandise is released, what happens and what are the implications? Can customs take it back? So as you progress through the point of the supply chain, customs examiners would like to test your knowledge on your knowledge of each link within the supply chain. And those are the links which bring the supply chain together up to the point of the final delivery. But, and I should say beyond, right? Because once the merchandise is delivered, then we have a bunch of other issues, right? Fines, penalties, liquidation issues. We have protests, for example. What if customs says that you need to pay more money than you thought of, and you disagree? How do you do that? You file a protest. Or you file a petition if it involves a penalty. Each chapter is a suggested outline of what you need to learn as you come to the customs broker exam and prepare for this. So you have free trade agreements. It's broken down in several volumes. So volume 2 continues with the journey through the supply chain and dealing with various issues that arise, and it ends with chapter 31, I would say. 32 is commonly tested forms. It's like a catch-all chapter. Customs examiners usually ask, what CBP form number should be used for entry for the warehouse or for foreign trade zone, or for the withdrawal, or for government entry, or for whatever. I think it deserves a separate chapter, even though it's intertwined with the rest, is because this is such an easy question to answer. You just need to know the number. So what this chapter does is it draws back from the previous customs broker exams all the forms that CBP has tested on. So that way, if you, by any chance, you kind of like, okay, what number is it? 3601, 3461, is it 7501? I don't know. You kind of look it up, and this chapter should be a helper. But basically, this is the outline which suggests all those various issues which cover most of the customs broker license examination. And the emphasis here is on most because there come some oddballs from, carrier requirements, VOCC requirements, right? VOCC is a vessel operating common carrier, which is a steamship line. And usually customs brokers do not deal with that stuff, right? But sometimes they may come about by way of something like Jones Act, right? And Jones Act would be is a law on cost-wide trade, and it would ask you something which is located in the Code of Federal Regulation Title 19, but at the same time, it is so rare that I do not think it deserves a separate chapter on. And this is something which is such an outlier that it can be attained through the practice of regular customs broker exam instead of looking at from the chapter perspective. So those are the supply chain links. What about looking at each link separately, right? I made an example of the one of those links, which is a growing concern in the world of customs, which deals with the intellectual property rights. So this is what the typical chapter looks like. Typical chapter is has a title, and then it has associated verb page. Each verb page has its own content. So what you do is if you have a smart device with the software, there is a QR code, you can scan it and you put it in, or you can just put in the short link. And as an example, let's take a look at how this particular intellectual property right chapter is made in the context of preparation for the customs license broker exam. So let's paste it in. So it prompts you to enter the passcode. Passcode is available here, right there. So you just paste it in. And visit the page. So each link has a dedicated discussion, right? So and the reason they have dedicated discussion is after years of teaching customs license broker exam prep, I found that to cover everything in one semester is extremely difficult because there is just so much, right? And what I ended up doing is I ended up taking a lot of shortcuts, and those shortcuts, due to the lack of time, and those shortcuts affected the quality. They didn't cover it in enough scope or in enough context to make it meaningful. And that was a problem because if I take shortcuts and sacrifice quality, that means that enough, if you take enough shortcuts, that means that I am shooting those who come to prepare in the food. This is something which I saw. That caused me to change the strategy. And the strategy now is to focus on those materials in great detail and quality, and make those available, and as the new law develops, go over it again, right? And once I tackled this particular link, I go to the next one. And in between, we cover various issues that come along. So this is the context of the class. Context of the class is to have use this textbook as an outline and to make sure that every link or additional links as they grow in, and we'll cover some additional links which are coming up for the next exam soon. They are covered in sufficient detail so that you can come prepared. So you have the lecture discussion over here, and beneath the lecture discussion you have supplemental material. Supplemental material is an extra stuff. This is the stuff that I use throughout the lecture, and also this is the stuff that fills in the blanks in a substantive form, meaning that it tells you more than you need to, but it gives you the better picture of what's going on, at least For example, this is the IPR, intellectual property rights. Customs, if you go to customs news page, they constantly flash you with those news. The customs has seized so many scooters because they were not properly trademarked. Or those customs seized those fake goods, etc., etc., etc. So this is this provides you the more context based on the official documents, based on in some cases the court decisions, right? So this is one of the more recent ones, Impression Products versus Lexmark, which means that in the context of this particular topic, the law is still developing. And of course, very important is the practice exam question. So there what's being done here is all the customs broker license exams being reviewed, and those that deal with intellectual property rights are being pulled into one piece. So as you prepare for this particular topic, you are able to see how it's been tested throughout the customs broker exam, starting from most recent and going down to the oldest, right? So you can see that three questions from April 2017. Then there wasn't much happening for a while in the world of intellectual property rights, was there, right? There was April 2016, only two questions. Then boom, again, four questions. So you can kind of see the pattern. But you will also be able to see as you go back to the history. So going back to April 2000, right, we have about 41 question collection. You will also be able to see, as Silvio also mentioned, that a lot of them repeat themselves. So you will be able to see what specific topics of the intellectual property right customs examiners are likely to test. So those are the supplements to the textbook material. And of course, the textbook material is the bare bones stuff, which covers outlines the things that you need to know. It underlines the buzzwords, it makes them italic, and it puts them in the context of various laws, right? And several things as you prepare. First of all, to understand how to use it, it is done in the context of the previous customs broker license exams. So you have this particular exam that came up, and it tests you on the fees, right? And which implies that, okay, you need to know something about fees which are attributable to the trademark process, registration process. That means you need to know what classes are. And that means that in the context of this previous exam question, you will learn how to use this particular chart. Finally, with respect to each chapter, you have the name of each trademark. The name of each topic within a topic, right? It's a kind of like a main idea. And it is based on the regulation. So this would be the Code of Federal Regulation, Section 19 CFR, Section 133.1, which customs examiners test you, or they like to test you on a number as well. So it's very useful, and it is very useful as not only as in answering the question, but it's also useful as a reference framework. Because using this section, you will know how customs examiners may test you, for example, a question like this. So that would be an example of the outline which which I suggest you take a look and work out within your own time schedule. As you can see, that outline is very long because each chapter is like an outline. Then there is a more detailed outline within the chapter, right, which is a chapter text, which is supplemented by the materials online. And the online materials are used as an updated version because it's kind of difficult to update the books all the time. So the outline, the verb part, the verb supplement part, is used as an updating tool to keep you updated as far as questions are concerned or as far as the changes in the regulations are concerned. So that would be a suggestion toward something which I call for the customs broker license exam is learning and understanding. So because if you learn and understand it, it makes it if you know what's going on, if you know what are customs examiners talking about, it makes it for you that much easier to answer the question. And it makes it that much easier for you to know where it's coming from. So this is a huge part of the preparation. Second part of preparation is straight up memorization. So of course, learning and understanding covers more deep knowledge, but sometimes memorization is a must. For example, going back to the introduction outline. So first of all, how do you memorize? Number one, you memorize through charts. You memorize, for example, through the flashcards, which is a useful tool. When I was preparing for the exam, I had various charts, and I would have separate corners, right? So one corner would be like warehouses corner, another corner would be like the CBP form 7501 corner, etc., etc. And I would have various charts on the wall, so I would wake up in the morning and I would go through them, right? And this is a memorization part, because simply knowing the structure, simply understanding that transportation inbound relates to part 18, right? It's kind of difficult to learn it and understand it, right? You just have to kind of memorize that transportation inbound is located in part 18. Because once you have a question on transportation inbound and you have that Code of Federal Regulation book with you, your fingers immediately go to that part 18, right? Instead of looking at the reference, okay, where is my stuff? So this is a reason why I suggest you to make your own or to use the ones that I already designed in the form of charts. And this is also a part of the textbook. Have those charts ready and have them posted somewhere. Or remake them in a way of flashcards or whatever. This is kind of subjective because things are all over the chart. But generally speaking, the bolder the stuff are, the more heavier they're being tested. Right? So you have customs bonds, for example, heavily tested. General order, not as heavy, but with consistent frequency. Marking. Entry, right? Those parts, they are the heavy hitters on the customs broker exam. Classification, heavy hitter. We talked about that. The new kid on the block, I suspect it's not going to go away or fade away by in a way of customs broker exam is the anti-dumping part the Enforce and Protect Act, which became part of Trade Facilitation and Trade Enforcement Act of 2015, effective, I believe, February 24, 2016, and which made a mandate, Congress told Customs, you have to design a procedure. We think that there is a lot of anti-dumping, countervailing duty evasion going on, so you have to design a procedure to catch those evildoers. So, they decided to, and the way they did it is they implemented a whole new part, part 165. Two questions appeared on it in April, in October 2017 exam, not counted toward the grade, because customs made a mistake of allowing the version of the CFR which still didn't have that portion of the exam, the part of the part of the regulation, because it's so new. But nevertheless, it is coming. It is coming. It is a trade priority. So we like. I suspect that I will need to make it more darker because it's simply so new. This is still in faded shape, faded color. Knowing what part is important.